So I'm a software engineer at Voxxed, which is a large company which has acquired lots of startups that are focused on marketplaces and media platforms. And specifically, I'm working in the software engineering and productivity team, which are in charge of creating services and tools for developers in order to automate part of their workflow. We will see one of these tools in this presentation too. And I'm the founder and the tech lead of Walmod, which is an open source tool focused on fixing static code analysis issues automatically for Java code. And recently I have developed the unit for Git, which is a proof of concept of the technology that I'm presented here. You can find me also in this Twitter, Raquel Pau, and I have also have some presentations in Voxxed Vienna, the Vox, and some Juke user groups. Do you feel recognized in that situation? Please raise your hands. Okay, that's not only my case. This happens usually because you want to create a contribution in a big repo that requires lots of tests, right? And you need to wait a lot in order to merge your contribution. Indeed, this is a real graphic of one of our repos that 1 year ago we started, few of us, and it was quite fast to integrate our changes. But during that year, many people were joining. And then we need to wait every time more minutes in order to integrate our changes. And this is what it's also a common situations for mono-repos, right? So the question about this talk is, how can we improve the time that we spend waiting for tests? Can we reduce the amount of tests that we can run? Theoretically, according to Martin Fowler, there are three main optimization strategies. The first one, which is running test subsets, is focused on filtering a static list of tests to run, while the other ones, explicit mappings and test impact analysis, is focused on resolving a dynamic list of tests to run. We will see each of these optimizations in this talk. The first one, that consists of running a subset of tests, is what you already do when you are creating a model for integration tests, which is different for unit tests, or when in terms of Gradle projects, you are defining different source sets, right? However, at the beginning was not like it, like this. And we can consider that when we started a project some years ago, we only used manual testing, right? And the first step that we did was to automate those manual testing with a huge test. And these tests were representing the end-to-end test. After some years, we realized that probably it doesn't scale to create an end-to-end test for every single patch that we want to add, right? Because the build is taking so much time. And then we decide to create unit tests from one side and end-to-end from the others. And the reason is because unit tests are fast because they are not linked to our services. Finally, and I think that it's the current scenario, we have at least three categories of tests. Unit tests with the corresponding mocks, integration tests that are focused on testing one communication layer, maybe the database or maybe an external service, and finally, end-to-end tests that sometimes are called smoke tests because they are validating the happy path of our applications before being deployed in the whole system. So, in conclusion, the problem about using end-to-end tests or tests that take a lot of time is because analyzing what is failing after adding a contribution or resolving a bug takes a while because we need to execute those tests maybe locally to figure out what is happening. And one visual model that tries to reproduce what are the best practices in our projects is the testing pyramid, where the main base are the unit tests, which are the ones that are designed for every single component. And we are validating the communication between them without using external services. Then we create iteration tests that are focused only on the communication layer, as I have said. But it takes a while, because probably we need to start those services. And finally, the end-to-end test, which can validate the happy path before deployment, and also we can use them as testing in production, because periodically we are reproducing the user behavior automatically with a real application deployed. The second strategy consists of having explicit test mappings. And what does it mean? Well, in the context of large companies, you need to take one important decision. Do you want to work with a monorepo, which means that all your microservices or all your services are in the same Git repository? Or you want to create a repository per service? Each of them has their own benefits. Indeed, the monorepo, what allows is applying refactors directly, because probably there are shared libraries across our microservices, or even client APIs. So when we decide to refactor one of those methods or properties, or smart editors also apply those refactorings into the consumer applications, right? But in the context of having one repository per service or per library, it means that usually this refactor needs to be done manually. However, this decision is also important to run our test, because what happens in a monorepo? The same situation that we have described before if you are not using the appropriate tools. Because lot of people are working on the same repo, and probably you get a very large queue of merge requests, and also you need to wait lots for all the tests. In the case of micro platforms, you are dividing that problem, giving the responsibility of running the test to the microservices, right? In Shipstead, we use the micro repository, but the update of the libraries is performed automatically. So there is a service that automatically updates the dependency graph between our services and libraries. And then, whenever we realize that there is a new release, we send automatically pull requests to all the consumers. And then, since it's a PR, we can get notified if one of the client repositories is not working with a new version. This approach is also shared by Netflix. However, this is not the only solution, because for monorepos, there are tools that allow us to define which are the source code pieces that are related to a specific test. And this is a fragment from Bazel. So in that case, the dependencies between test and sources are explicit because the developers are writing them. This is a fragment from Bazel that is a tool that has created by Google, but also Twitter and Facebook, since they are working with monorepos, has created their own tools in order to filter or propose a way to make an incremental build. And then the last one, the test impact analysis, which is the focus of this tool. And the first tool that is supporting this for Java projects that is agnostic from the programming language on the JVM is this one, the JUnit for Git. The question is, can we infer those explicit mappings instead of leaving on the developer's responsibility to put them in a build file? Let's see. Here I have a Maven project where there are two modules. A data access object module, which is focused on implementing the operations for a database. Here we have the implementation that is inserting messages and also is querying all the messages. This is the interface, but also we have another module, which is core. Which contains only a functionality, which is the search engine, that uses the interface to filter message for a keyword, right? If we use this tool for this project, let's create the mappings first for the master branch with Maven test. And here we can see that the database is up because, well, we are using Archelion and then it's launching a Docker image that is Postgres, so we need to wait a bit. And then the test finished. But let's see the important part. The iteration test takes almost 20 seconds, right? But the unit test looked that it takes less than 1 second. So do we need to run this iteration test for every single feature that we want to implement? So let's imagine that we create a new branch, which is RPAU Voxxed. And then now we run again these tests with Maven test. We haven't applied any change, right? So here we have. We have skipped the iteration test automatically, and the unit test is run. Why is important running unit test? Unit tests are always recommended to be executed because are the ones that are needed to generate the code coverage reports. This is a good practice to enforce a high level of code coverage. Otherwise, maybe people is only creating end-to-end test. So the main idea of this repo consists of having a model for integration test that optionally can be run or not depending on our changes, and then run always the unit test, because otherwise checks in our pull request that checks this code coverage wouldn't work. And then let's imagine that we edit the source code and then we add, for example, a comment. Right, in that case, since I have modified not the test, but the DAO implementation, the engine should be able to detect which test needs to be run. And take in mind that, okay, in that case, we have a component that is directly used from the test, but usually there are many components that are executed from the tests. And they are not in the first level, but maybe in the 12th level or whatever. So the engine is detecting all these graphs and then evaluating which test needs to be run. And in this case, we have executed all again, right? So the idea should work. We have split that problem in two steps. The first one is generate those explicit mappings automatically by analyzing the repository, right? And the second one is to generate the ignore annotations dynamically in order to skip the test that we want to ignore, because they are not related to our changes. Well, at Shipstead we have these requirements for this kind of tool. The first one is that it needs to be language agnostic, always in the JVM, but we have several projects written in Scala, some of them in Kotlin and some of them in Java. So we need a generic approach for all of them, right? The second requirement is that it needs to work in Maven and also in Gradle at least. So it needs to be a solution that should work in every build platform that are for Java projects. The third one is backwards compatible. So it means that we should avoid as much changes as possible in the current tests, right? We need to take that benefit without applying modifications. And finally, it should work offline, at least for the incremental part, because master is always built in Travis, in our case, which is remote. The test impact reports. How does it look? Well, we need to have the test class, the test method, and resolve the classes that are related to those tests. Well, let's focus on trying to resolve which are the test methods. And this is a question for you. Okay? So if you have paid attention into our requirements, you will be able to answer. So how can we detect which are the test methods to execute, that are, is going to execute? The answer is by a unit runner, the answer B by code analysis, the C by unit listener, and the D, none of them is valid. So how many of you have chosen A? Okay, that's good. The answer A is wrong, because the JUnit runner is what is executed to initialize the test class. So it's what we do, for example, to start the services, but it's not controlling which tests are executed. How many of you have chosen the B? Okay, you are also wrong. And the reason is because since we are language agnostic, we cannot rely in code analysis, okay? And also because in Java, well, in JVM, we support reflection, which means that classes can be loaded dynamically, right? And the correct answer is C, because this is an interface of JUnit that if you implement that component, you get notifications when a test is going to be executed, and also when the test has finished, right? And for this card, the D is not correct. In conclusion, to refresh the concept of JUnit, this valid for JUnit 4 and JUnit 5. So the listeners are components that I have explained that receive those notifications whenever a test is going to start, the system notifies the listener. And one important point is that we can have multiple listeners in an application. It's not restricted. Since because JUnit, we can also have one JUnit runner per test class. And JUnit listeners are defined in our build system, right? The runners are the ones that run the methods, but you cannot access to them, so they are the initializers of the class. And finally, the assertions, that are the statements that we are writing in the test in order to validate that the tests are valid. Well, the second part, we now have chosen a way to discover, to resolve which are the methods, the test methods of a project. But how can we resolve the classes that are executed in some way from that test method? You have here two options, four options, bytecode analysis, A, by instrumentation, by JUnit API, or none of them. So how many of you also think is A in that case? Well, you have learned. And option B, by instrumentation. Good. C, JUnit API. Okay. Are you afraid to participate? In that case, it's instrumentation, right? Because the Java Virtual Machine allows to get notified whenever a class is loaded. So you can intercept those calls and make something. However, there are other tools that are implementing the impact test analysis right now, which is smart testing from Archilean, but it's focused on code analysis, so they are focused on analyzing the imports of those classes, and they build a graph based on the imports, which has the drawback of reflection, and Visual Studio, which is not for Java, of course. Are you familiar with this graph? This is a code coverage report, where you see in green those lines that are covered by a test, and in red the ones that can be executed, right? And how code coverage reports work? In the same way that we have chosen, by instrumentation. They are injecting code in our bytecode in order to get notified whenever a statement is executed, or a method, or a class. So I propose this design, which consists of, as we have explored, having a listener that starts the report because it receives when a test has started. And then, when the test method is executed, several classes are loaded. And for each of them, whenever the JVM detects that the class needs to be executed, by instrumentation, we inject code in the constructors of this class in order to get the notification that this class will be loaded or will be used from the test. And why from the constructors? Because the class during an execution is loaded only once by test. But probably we have creating objects of this class in several tests, and we want to receive that notification for each of these tests, right? And then we close the report for every time we receive the notification that the test has finished, right? Well, but there is a step which consists of modifying the test, adding the ignore annotation, right? Because we want to filter the test that we don't want to execute. But also, we have mentioned that the constructors will get a new method that they are notifying us. We need to decide a way to do this, but those changes that are applied needs to be outside from the source code, okay? And also they need to be outside of the class file, because the class file is what is delivered into an artifact, right? So it needs to be temporarily applied in the classes that are loaded. And for this reason, we have selected a widely used library, which is JavaSyst, which, if I'm not wrong, is also used by Hibernate, for example, and allows you giving a set of bytes that corresponds to a class that is loaded, modify these bytes. and the class definition. And with that approach, we are able to add this ignore annotation and at runtime, but it's only applied during the execution of those tests. So the compilation classes of the test are never touched, right? Well, in that context, we have the testing bug report that we have executed from master branch, for example, because it's a reference. And then if we run again the tool, we calculate the delta. So a question is, where do we store those reports, those test impact reports? Because it looks like, in the demo, looks like magic, right? So we need to decide an approach to decide the place to store this test. And I have selected here for options, again, an external service by using files, by using Git notes, or any of these. Option A, raise your hands if you think that it's an external service, like code coverage, checks, or whatever. Okay, that's wrong. And it's because one of our requirements is that it's, the solution needs to work offline. So it cannot be an external service for that reason, and also requires more effort for us. Answer B, using files in the same repo. It's not a very clean solution because all the commits get dirty by these reports, right? And finally, using Git notes. Well, that is easy, right? Have you heard about Git notes? It's not a quite common concept, but you have these commands already for Git repos. And it allows to add metadata for a specific SHA. And this information is not stored in your branch. There is a branch for the category of Git notes that you want to add. So for this tool, for example, we have created a new ref, which is a branch at the end, which is ref, notes, and tests. All the notes branch are under the ref's notes root path. And in order to read these notes in the repository, you need to define the branch that you want to use. And then whenever you type git log, you get them. So the reports are stored inside the git notes. And how do we use those commands from the tool? Using the ggit library, which it's quite easy with a build pattern and allows us to set this note. Let me show you how looks like the git note. You see? Since I'm using the tool only for the integration test, I have here that for that method of that test class, I'm referring this class. And I'm only taking into consideration the classes that are under repository. All the ones that belongs to external library, does it make sense? Okay. So in conclusion, Git notes allows us to build a tool without relying on a server. And also, these new refs are not always fetched from your repo. If you integrate JUnit for Git, it will download it automatically if you need it. And so they are not affecting to your clone operation. And they are metadata for commits. So every time you create a new node, you need to specify the SHA that is related to. And it's quite common also use Git notes from Gerrit. Gerrit is the code review tool from Google, and If you want, you can store that the static code analysis issue, the amount of static code analysis issues, or the code coverage of a contribution as a Git node. And this is the repository that is using Gerrit. And how it will affect to our workflow? Well, I assume that there is a base branch that is called master. So we need to generate those test impact reports for every single commit that is in master branch whenever we create a new contribution. So the idea is those Git nodes are part of our commit. And then when we decide to create a new branch, we create as many commits as we want, and locally and also remotely, only the tests that are related to our changes will be executed. But after merging our changes to the base branch, the whole list of tests will be executed, but it's not affecting anymore to our productivity. And this is why the Git nodes get updated again. And how looks like the design? So, well, there is a moment where when the agent is invoking the operation of ignoring tests that are not related to our changes. And then, well, we need to recover these Git nodes. So the report storage in this case relies on Git. With ggit library, we get those nodes, and then we proceed to add the ignore annotation. This is the conclusion of this workflow. Well, an important point that I want to mark is that, again, this is an interesting approach in order to filter integration tests, but it's not for filtering unit tests. You won't get benefit on them because they are already fast, right? And you should need code coverage reports from them. And also because integration test that we have seen, it may take several minutes, right? There is a case in our organization that recently someone mentioned 10 minutes of integration test, okay? And the reason is because they rely on databases, maybe Docker or not, it doesn't matter, and external APIs. So WireMock, for example, is what we find in integration test. And the take-home message that I want that you get from this talk is that there is a testing depth, which is also a technical depth on test, which is the time that you need to wait for test in order to integrate your work. This is already reported as a category of technical depth. There are three main optimization strategies to reduce the testing depth. The first one is running test subsets that probably you are already doing by categories, applying categories to different test subset. Test explicit mappings, which is something that only mono-repos companies are focused on by creating their own build tools. Or alternatively, I think that in the Java world, we can rely on test impact analysis, right? Which is the last approach that we have checked. And finally, how I have built Gunit for Git, using all the concepts that we have learned here. Gunit listeners, agents, Java Assist, and Gkit. And if you have any question, now it's a moment.
So when are these test reports generated to tell the dependencies of tests to code changes or to classes, as you said? So if I locally change my code, I need to run this generation target, right?
You don't need to do this if it's already in master, because it is downloaded. It's fetched, and then you don't need to run this master branch after there is a first execution. You need to run the first time that you integrate this tool. But not...
But if I change the code, then these dependencies will change. So I need to recreate them, right?
When you apply changes, the tool with the Git status decides which are the classes that you are touching, creating, or adding. and depending on the last test analysis report, decides to execute your test or not. But it's not creating a new report for the delta, which are your changes.
Is the test report incremental, or is it always the overall report?
It's always the overall, but it's because it's in master. Okay. So you don't need to wait to those fields. That's the key point. But you shouldn't have that amount of tests for integration. In that case, I would say this is what you are already executing. So you are moving from executing for every PR to delegate it into master, because the PR is ensuring that your changes are right. Sorry. Well, if you add a new class, probably you have a new test for that. But if you add a new class and it's not affecting any test, it doesn't matter. It won't execute those tests because it's not affecting those tests. Well, that's a good point, really a good point. I think that those cases I haven't covered yet, maybe, vale? So I would say if the class is loaded by reflection in some way in the past, yes, it is considered. But if it's loaded by reflection in a new scenario, this is not covered with that strategy. That's fine. That's all right.
That's what I meant before, that you actually need to recreate those dependencies every time you change anything, because any change could have like invisible impacts and cause new dependencies on existing tests.
Well, in that case, we are saying like a new class.
Yeah.
If it's a new class, maybe it makes sense to get an option to run in that case, all the tests. But class modifications are handled as well.
And you mentioned that the reason why you always execute all JUnit tests is that you need those execution for code coverage. Right?
Yeah.
But also integration tests contribute to code coverage. So I don't understand this argument.
According to our opinions as a team at Voxxed, integration tests shouldn't be part of the code coverage. It's like, you can include them, but I think that you should focus more on unit tests rather than integration tests.
We assume that the code coverage of integration caused by integration tests is a real subset of the code coverage that is caused by unit tests.
Yeah. Well, the classes are mapped directly to paths, and then it's how the git status is executed, and then you resolve the test that you want to run.
Yeah, but you just record class dependencies. So as soon as one class changes, then all the tests that have this class as a dependency are executed, right? But
yep.
If you only change a single line in this class, then maybe only one of the tests to be re-executed, right?
Exactly. You can go farther,
yeah.
and decide different granularity levels, and this is something that can be improved, of course.
Are you planning this?
Well, this is an initial approach of an idea that I think that matters to consider. So let's see how it goes.
Also test things like configuration. I measure the impact of like something that is not classes. For example, this pre-qualification.
Exactly. In case of configuration files, all the tests needs to be executed, which are the ones that are usually in source main resources. But
is there an SPI? Can this be extended somehow?
Yeah, of course, it's open source. The repo, so you feel free to contribute if you want. All right. So that's all, and thank you very much for being here.